I try to be.
We are live.
Thank you very much.
Cool.
Awesome. Thank you. Okay. All right, so what he's talking about is on the tub itself, the tub spout, there is a it's a female connection that goes to half inch or three quarter pipe. It's a graduated fitting. What he's saying is in that wall, there is the nipple. And he's saying that there could be a galvanized nipple. In other words, they ran the plastic pipe to that galvanized nipple. They ran the plastic pipe to the other, and maybe it's still offering the issue. Now, being a devil's advocate here, in this case, it worked, right? So that's good. We're going to check that. But water's flowing through. He still has some galvanized pipe. It's flowing through the galvanized pipe to service all the other appliances. It's going through the plastic. In the case of the bathtub, it's got another piece of galvanized that's going through. Why wouldn't the water be stained from the other galvanized that has some deposits in, or maybe it doesn't have any deposits in? Change the nipple in the bathtub. That we'll go from there. I hope that helps. Thanks for the call, David. I appreciate it. All right, let's go to Mary. Mary, welcome.
Well, good morning, Gary. I have a question about a hot water furnace. It's actually a boiler, and it's causing, well, my house has, the bedrooms are too hot. It's a ranch-style home, and that hot water goes directly from the boiler down through a pipe in the ceiling of the basement to the bedroom.
So we have not posted the link yet, which is why you're watching video of us not saying or doing anything, but there should be viewers in here, hopefully, in just a second.
And my living room is several degrees cooler than the bedroom end of the house. So living room, kitchen, and
you give, well, you give the chances of there being a curved penis at this time. Can I have my monster?
Sucker bet, man. Sucker bet. The curve ball is real.
Wait, is it a curve ball or what is it?
It's the Peronis.
The link's on our Facebook page if you want to share it on your
No, you've had HVAC boiler guys take a look at it. They don't have an answer.
No.
So you had it on a zone format, correct?
Yes.
And now you no longer have it on a zone.
Right.
Okay. So that's probably causing the issue, correct?
Well, apparently.
Yes.
But it was that way before the house was even zoned.
Okay.
And that was what we did to remedy the problem.
Okay. So, but now that zone system's not working. And the problem,
I wonder if they can hear the
so the problem is really
the show.
It's
like over the headphones over there.
Well, I'm now in the chat.
I'm sure they got that same thing. So the real question is,
they should be able to hear it. We might have to turn it up for them some.
Mm-hmm.
It's always been an issue.
And this has been the problem just every year. It's just an aggravation because you don't need the bedrooms to be so warm as you do in the area of the house. And I've been, maybe over the years, 7 or 8 different HVAC people here. And either they don't want to deal with it or they don't know because they don't.
I need to remember that we are on live video right now and not say things.
I was worried. I've been worried this whole time. Like, I hope he remembers that we're live.
I started to. Started to. Would have been bad.
Did you see what I shared it as?
No, I didn't see what you shared it as. Motherfucker. Derp. Derp.
I have hurt and I have derp.
Oh, my God. No comment.
No comment?
No comment.
I don't know. I don't have an answer. I would probably.
All right. Super Dave's on standby. Yay.
Oh.
Let's see. Yeah. Already got 4 viewers, eh? I apologize to all of you.
All right, let's get to next. Go to Nevada. We have Bob.
Hello, Mr. Zo.
gentlemen. How are you doing?
Yes, sir. Just fine.
Are you in the chat tonight?
Maybe. Did you just get something?
I'm in the chat right now.
Did I send anything across?
I'm not seeing anything from you in the chat.
What the fuck is this?
Oh, okay. The chat continues to be mine. Who run Chat Town? Embargo on.
This is some shit. This is some shit. How am I not in my own goddamn chat? There's nothing. There's nothing here in the chat. Really? Did you?
Are you on the YouTube one?
What the fuck is this?
They're like trying to walk you through fighting the chat. They're like, it's on the right side.
Can you verify, please? Look. Nothing. YouTube, nothing.
Weird. There's... Yeah, his chat's not working. Call the help desk. That was a fucking, yeah, that's him.
Who was it, Eric or T. Revy?
Nate.
Ooh.
Did you say the forbidden name?
I did say the forbidden name.
It's not cool, man. White Monster is the best monster.
Let me guess. Tom Kelly.
Tom Kelly.
Bam.
Oh, greetings from NKY. Is that New York? What is NKY?
Northern Kentucky, Jack.
Oh.
Who said that?
Blue State Refugee.
Okay, that's fucking scary. If that guy shows up in the parking garage, the blaze. Because I don't know who that is, and that's weird. No, we're kidding. We're kidding.
Miguel Dilbert.
I know him. He doesn't strike me as that weird. Only a little.
Tom, don't project your feelings on me.
He's not tall enough to project his feelings on you. Bam!
Oh!
We're getting started at 7:06. We have no producer.
Oh, shit. I hope we can start at 7:06. Did he just run in there? Ooh, he has a point. We should charge sponsorship for our laptop stickers.
Honey, show Scooter the apartment. Is that up? It's a wolf-dog hybrid. So technically still a game.
Premium scores are used to 90% of credit decisions, so get your credit swagger on and go to Experian.com. Become a member of Experian Credit Tracker and take charge of your score.
Do we have Keith?
Melody, I always look nervous when it's live radio.
So how about you go tell them they got dead fucking air on their talk radio station, since that's like something they might want to know. I bet you anything they're down at the ESPN.
Yep. He's like at a run right now. He's like, oh.
Dead air's a thing, right? I mean, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, how very creepy. We getting going at 7:06? Don't forget to call, dude.
We think that she had a lot to do with the radicalization process and perhaps with Mr. Fruit's radicalization.
Nick Orpheus, who are you, buddy? Just came in and screamed, bent dick commercial, gray man.
Chat! I got chat!
Oh!
Yes! Do you have a browser sticker on?
No.
Okay.
Not yet.
You might want to get your cord under your beard, because right now it looks very state troopery.
You like getting dressed like you're going to invade Poland every day?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Yes. Shopping puts personal information out there, and big retailers have been breached. Does shopping online increase risk? Yes. Online shopping leaves a trail of personal information behind. Does giving fruitcake as a gift increase risk? No. Not very original, and the fruitcake may never get eaten. Only increase risk.
I can't see the problem is with the chapping right there. I don't think look, that's a good
you,
idea.
Why don't you focus on the actual guest and let me handle the animals?
Why you gotta be like that, Jack?
Because I know what they do in the chat. I've been there, man. The mods here suck. Brandon, of course we like Mexico. Well, I love Mexico. I don't know how John feels about Mexico.
As long as I don't have to go there, I'm fine with it.
Who am I going to take to go to my Mexican whorehouse shooting then?
Not me. Sean, you can take Sean.
Hashtag not about that life.
No, I'm not.
Oh, also hashtag would absolutely take Sean.
Sean would be a good motherfucker to take to that. Sean, who has no last name on live anything.
Just... Hashtag.
No shit, Sherlock. Yeah.
Who doesn't like Taco Bell?
Am I on the toilet losing every ounce of humanity I've ever owned? Because then I don't like Taco Bell the same way I don't like White Castle or Chipotle. But before and after that moment, I'm cool.
Oh, okay. Distraction noodles are the only way to derail.
Jack makes a doorway look like a little hobbit then.
Where is that?
That's
at?
Not anywhere you got.
Don Blankenship was once the chief executive of Massey Energy, which operated West Virginia's Upper Big Branch Coal.
Is he going to fucking call Dave or not? Hello.
Guys, on the live stream, we're real questionable as to what's going to happen with the actual radio show, so. Miguel, disliking Taco Bell only means that you have money, not that you're a bad person.
The outgoing line not working?
Yeah, no, the outgoing line is not working.
I'll have him call in. Are incoming lines working?
No, it's just something about the phone connection was lost.
Live radio, everybody. Anything can happen.
Do not start the show quite yet, then. Please play another minute or two of commercials.
Fuck it, we do it live.
You guys had one job! One job you guys have!
because Montgomery Cyclery has free professional bike assembly. Get guaranteed lowest prices and the best selection of bikes, gear, accessories, and clothing. Kids' bikes starting under $100, and adult bikes starting under $200. To make things even merrier for your holidays, want your free service only at Montgomery Cyclery's 6 Cincinnati area locations.
Come on and see at Montgomery Cyclery.
Men, if you're like me, you appreciate the feeling of a clean, smooth shave.
Oh, man.
A sort of shave that cuts clean without the burn. So why are you messing around with generic razors that cost $32 for an 8-pack when you can shave with Harry's?
So the incoming line's not working either.
Blades for half the price. And if saving money and a clean shave isn't incentive enough, Harry's will give you their starter set, complete with a razor, three of their world-famous blades, and shaving cream for just $15.
Hold on to the night.
Yay!
Not this time you didn't, cocksucker. How have you been?
Good, man. How are you?
I'm good. Hey, we're on a live Google Hangout right now, so.
Are you really?
Periscope? That's like what naked chicks do.
Can we have naked chicks in here?
Bulgy, naughty looking legs, not to mention.
Let's talk about that off air.
Bro, do you even meow?
We're good to go right now?
Yeah, we're good to go.
Are you just trying to see if the fat guy will fucking drop over before the radio show? Yeah, you are. Yeah, I'm going to run up and get him to like try and run, get his heart rate up, and then I'm going to scare him.
I was scared to death, yeah.
Well.
Shit, it's the mean one. No!
Literally, this shit has never happened to me before.
How come the real radio show is the only one with the problems on Sunday? Have you noticed?
Yeah.
Woo! Pull my balls out of my belly button.
Learn how you can protect the assets you worked so hard to accumulate.
Stand by.
That was lame.
This program do not necessarily reflect those of 55 KRC, the talk station.
Welcome to Ballistic Radio. Join us as we discuss hard-won self-defense lessons, as well as the information you need to survive a violent encounter. Listen as armed professionals, industry experts, and gunfight survivors help answer all your firearms and self-defense questions while exploring your rights and responsibilities as an armed citizen. Ballistic Radio, just the facts. And now, here's your host, John Johnston.
Welcome to Ballistic Radio! I'm your host, John Johnston. Remember, you can always listen to past shows at ballisticradio.com when we get around to posting them, because we still haven't put last week's up, even though it's been ready to go for like days and 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 days. And also, get the latest behind-the-scenes info, arguments, silliness, impending fights based off of other people's Instagram posts at facebook.com/ballisticradio. Co-hosting with me this evening is Jack.
Woo!
How you doing?
I'm doing all right, you know?
My heart rate's up, and not just because of the Monster energy drink. We were having some phone problems before the show. This is our second show that we are live video broadcasting via Google Hangouts, so that's adding like a nice air of complication?
Yeah, I would say that's the word.
Yes, something like that. We got a great show tonight. We're going to be joined by Super Dave Harrington, who will hopefully entertain and amuse all of us, as I actually know he will, because I talked to him the other day and he had a lot of really cool things to say. Just a quick reminder first, this segment brought to you by Wilson Combat. Wilson Combat, makers of the finest custom 1911s, ARs, and scatterguns since 1977. Legacy of quality, innovation, and service. Learn more about their firearms and accessories at www.wilsoncombat.com. And also, Aridus Industries and the patent-pending QDC, quick detach side saddle shell carrier. Available now for pre-order. Check out the new rigid interchangeable side saddle carrier, changing how you look at shotguns forever. Find out why Steve Fisher, Chris Fry, and myself all call it the best hard mount side saddle carrier ever invented. Would you like to know more? Find out more at eridusindustries.com. So, without further ado, joining us, Super Dave Harrington. Dave, how are you doing tonight, man?
Just fine, John. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing better now that I know that the phones are working, which was a major, major question about 4 minutes ago. So, there is that. For those that don't know, man, can you just go over your background real quick, and then we'll spend a couple minutes on setting the show up, hop into a commercial break, and then go from there.
Okay. I basically had an eclectic military background. I started out in the Navy, did a short tour with them, Air Force, and eventually worked my way into the Army and did the infantry, Airborne Ranger, Special Forces line, and worked pretty much in anti and counterterrorism involvements over the years. And as I were getting into the 21 years of my career, I did a total of 23 years competitively, and that was my end as far as the competitive scene of IDPA and USPSA, as well as the shooting industry. And I retired in June of 2003 and have been an independent trainer since then.
So one of the things that, you know, we talked the other day, and there are some videos of you floating around online. One of the things that I find really kind of interesting about what you do, you're very much a, what you got on you is what you got on you, and the skills that you've developed are the skills that you've developed, and that's, you're going to need those to solve whatever problem you find yourself dealing with.
Right, absolutely. One of the baseline phrases that is absolutely accurate is your mind is your greatest weapon.
Right.
So regardless of the tools that you have to solve the problem, your decision-making process in respect to solving that problem is critical, because it's everything is based on decision and action.
And that seems to be one of the things that a lot of people miss when they really first start out on this. You know, they'll ask questions like, oh, what gun should I carry? What bullet should I put in my gun? You know, should I have a flash? And they're all very technical-related questions, you know, or hardware related questions. That's probably not the most important thing to work on first, is it?
Actually, you have to assemble the tools that you're going to use. And, thoroughly know and understand, you know, the tools that you have at your disposal before you can begin to really problem solve.
So
one key aspect is, you know, for example, excuse me, I got a frog in my throat.
It happens on live radio without fail, actually. It's one of those, it's like a Murphy's Law type thing.
As far as the basic mechanics of shooting, before you can really start to work on what I would consider or call tactical problem solving. And there's two sides of the coin. You know, there's professionals that have trained for years in respect to being as prepared to handle confrontation.
Let me interrupt just real quick, because we got to go to break, Dave. Hold that thought. We're talking with Dave Harrington right now. You're listening to Ballistic Radio.
Your voice. They're going to raise action. 55 KRC, the talk station. With the progress made in the fight against AIDS.
Just FYI, you didn't kill his mic when we went on the break. I grabbed it. Don't worry. You live with that?
I'm like, okay, let me make sure. Oh, and Rin joins us. Thank God, because it was a sausage party beforehand.
Melody's in here somewhere.
If she's not talking, I thought she might have logged off.
You want to turn that up on the...
Yeah, doctor's calling the house, and he's trying to give me five shows to play around tonight. This is not convenient, so...
Move quicker, Jack. Move quicker. Quick. Turn it up. Turn it up. Come on. Move. 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 You just shocked the shit out of yourself? It'd be that scene in Almost Famous. 30 seconds. Welcome back to Ballistic Radio. This segment brought to you by Dark Star Gear. Whether you know the color of the boathouse at Hereford or only know the color of your mom's basement, Cheeto stained socks, and Instagram start page background, Dark Star Gear has a solution to your gear carrying needs. Check out their clip-on holster for small semi-autos and revolvers, or their highly adjustable full-size AIWB holster. They even have a belt wrap sheath for popular fixed blade centerline knives to really tie your EDC together, like that one rug I used to have. Designed, developed, and pressure tested for real life, not social media. Find out more at darkstargear.com. And also, Aridus Industries and the patent-pending QDC, quick detach side saddle shell carrier, available now for pre-order. Would you like to know more? Visit aridusindustries.com. So we're talking with Dave Harrington. Dave, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here, Bob.
Excellent. Well, the reason why I ask is because there's a high probability that I make a mistake and hang up on you, because I've done it before. And
no worries.
I'd do that. I'm sure. Actually, I wouldn't do it. I'd be the producer, but it would happen. Anyway, now that's a tangent. You were talking before the break about the importance of knowing your gear, and you're right in the middle of something. I cut you off. I apologize.
No worries. Assembling your gear is critical, and what a lot of people fail to do initially is inquire with people that know in respect to what is the best gear to get started with. There are many different manufacturers out there. One of the key things from an individual standpoint is the size of your hands. What handgun fits well, is comfortable. What is your application? Does your duty position require a specific type handgun that you have to learn how to use extremely well? Is it a civilian concealed carry type application, up to the military application? Knowing and understanding your equipment is critical, and then of course there's your knowledge base in respect to the basic mechanics of shooting.
Would you say that? So I completely agree with you, but it seems like the hard thing for a lot of people is to find someone that's actually knowledgeable to ask those questions to.
One thing I do know is anybody that has, through their own self-development and the pursuit of acquiring skill at arms, has gone through several different weapons types, certainly has, probably several boxes of old gear, stuff they thought was legit, only to find out through use it wasn't necessarily the best application. There's an evolution, so to speak, that everybody goes through.
Right. So I guess we've kind of hit on the starting point as far as where people start at. One of the things that I kind of want to switch gears, because there's been another terrorist event, which I guess they just finally got around to classifying it as a terrorist event in San Bernardino. And this was getting thrown around a lot after the Paris thing, and it's getting thrown around even more now, is the whole, you know, people change their gear or training after an event like this, which I don't necessarily disagree with, depending on what it is. But one of the popular things seems to be adding like a car long gun. What do you think about that?
Well, the fact of the matter is, you know, the situation is going to dictate. You know, I understand the train of thought in respect to being as prepared as possible to deal with a violent encounter. And, you know, there are those that choose to have additional firepower in their vehicle. But, you know, what are the chances of something transpiring that you're going to be in your vehicle?
Right.
You know, normally, you know, it's transportation, you'll be out and about. If that set of circumstances transpire, the key aspect would be, you know, if it plays out that way, use your vehicle as a weapon first.
Right.
But then again, you kind of have to narrow the field in respect to the point of interest, because we're primarily focused on civilians, correct?
Yeah. Yeah, I'd say that's a good place to focus for today, at least. Next time we can talk about a little more. Yeah.
My biggest input on that point of interest would be, you know, I don't fault anybody being as prepared as possible to protect themselves or their loved ones.
Not at all.
But if you look at it from a standpoint of the social conscience, for example, you know, if I were, you know, had a full kit set up in my vehicle and I happened to be in close proximity to a terrorist attack, what is the feasibility of me actively going on the offensive in support of trying to, you know, contain or eliminate the threat? How will that be perceived, you know, by the social conscience and law enforcement itself? Another critical point of interest is, if I were to choose to do that, when the law enforcement community finally shows up in order to contain that set of circumstances, they're basically, they very realistically could go to guns on me.
Right.
So, that's a pretty big animal to tackle.
Well, so it seems like one of the things that, you know, as you alluded to, I'm all for people being as prepared as possible and doing what they feel they need to do to best prepare themselves for the largest range of circumstances they might find themselves in. I don't disagree with that at all. I guess where I start to question is when, you know, when you and I talk about it, or we're talking about it now, we bring up points like, well, you know, how are the cops going to look at us as a responder once they show up? You know, what steps do we need to take to give ourselves the highest probability of success in that situation? But a lot of people, when they start making decisions like that, don't go that far. You know what I mean?
Right, understood. And they're not, the biggest thing besides being, like, materially equipped to handle something like that, the psychological preparation is the main key to success in that decision making
process. You're listening to the 5-minute service on Fox.
The producer is just like failing at life today. I'm sorry, Dave. Try that one more time.
Okay. Let me preface my answer with this simple fact. Law enforcement, the baseline mentality for law enforcement, as I understand it, casualties are unacceptable. Whereas from a military background and upbringing, casualties are certainly expected.
Right.
And of course, that's planned for. And as things roll, from an open combat standpoint, you know, that's going to happen. Law enforcement it's to an extent, and I'm talking either the major percentage of your first responders are going to be your patrol officers, and they're looking at individual survival as well as the survival of their partners if they have one. There was a one of the pro tips I was asked for Panteo Productions was what was my train of thought in respect to defensive mindset, and I do not I don't really support or agree with possessing a defensive mindset. To me, that's more of the mentality of I'm going to sit back and wait till something happens before I make a decision about what I'm going to do about it. Whereas from what I would consider a military mindset, I'm going to do a rapid assessment on the circumstances as they develop and make the appropriate decisions and take the appropriate actions that's going to ensure my survival or the elimination of the threat.
Well, now that's an interesting point, and I kind of want to hold on that for just a second. A lot of people, and I'm not quite sure if it's because of a lack of understanding of the legal things involved in a deadly force encounter once deadly force is authorized, or if it's just how, you know, the public views these things, but, you know, getting the idea across that once lethal force is authorized, you can, for lack of a better term, assault a position or an individual or whatever, and that fighting defensively is not the best option. That seems to be sorely missing in the community.
Right, and I agree, but those never down to the individual. So it's critical that an individual understand what their rules of engagement are, what level of authority do they possess to apply lethal force. For the majority of civilians, it's fairly limited to the concealed carry, the person that's, licensed and can legally carry a weapon for self-defense. That's the baseline. And there are circumstances that transpire where, people that are armed do respond to violent encounters and help mitigate those circumstances in respect to saving someone else's life. That certainly takes place.
Well, yeah, it actually, it happens a lot more than, and I'm going to say this and regret it immediately, but mainstream media would like people to think. I can think of three or four cases just in the last year where a good guy with a gun has certainly, done a third party defense and done a great thing for people.
Right. But as the whole terrorism scheme of maneuver continues to develop in this country, it's going to take quite a bit of social understanding if those circumstances transpire, where John Q bails out of his vehicle and, engages, like active shooters, a certain number of active shooters. How is that going to be perceived? Because this country has had, its own trying times with vigilantism and that whole death wish kind of
stigma
thought process.
Right. Let me interrupt again, Dave. I'm sorry. We got to go to break. Right now we're talking with Dave Harrington. You're listening to Ballistic Radio.
55 KRC. Every time you donate from your closet, from your garage,
no!
Every time you donate to Goodwill,
go for the gusto. But you don't know about the blood, sweat, and tears.
Your donation. Are we rapping?
I was just talking. Disabilities work and losing some of your tears.
Losing some of yourself through days past gone by. Hopefully it don't manifest in the wrong guy. Egomaniac in the brain. I don't know how. Anyway.
Melody is being so positive in the chat.
Wow, yes she is. Strong work, guys. I bet she missed the part where Mr. Producer Man. So did you like lean on the wrong button on the board and?
The Fox News button, like, it doesn't play after the last note.
So what that was I asked you a direct question. You're like, yeah, well, it was this. Yeah, I did that. Sorry. I didn't say the phone thing was your fault, and I'm just giving you shit. It's okay.
Guys in the chat, you guys are being really quiet tonight. It worries me.
I think they're like listening or some shit.
Like they're plotting. Because you know Cali boy and Tom, they'd be plotting on us.
So he edited the hold on. It's I know.
All right.
He edited the description after the words, but since I posted the link on my personal page and it grabbed the original description, there it is right there.
What did he change it to?
He got rid of that first sentence after he pretended to be Yoda. I'm waiting for the curved dick to come out of nowhere.
That's what she said.
Bazinga!
I hate that show.
That gasoline goes down when the president is not as popular?
Because lower crude oil prices is mainly spent. It's passed through. Stand by.
Welcome back to Ballistic Radio. This segment brought to you by TopGunSupply.com. TopGunSupply.com is your web source for fine firearms, parts, and accessories. True product specialists committed to delivering the highest level of customer support to you. They carry top name brands including Ed Brown, Wilson Combat, Les Bears, Six Hour, and many more, as well as premium AR pattern rifles. Whether you are looking to protect yourself, are a first-time gun buyer, or a competitive shooter, TopGunSupply.com can satisfy your firearms needs. TopGunSupply.com, your premier source for SIG parts and accessories. And also, Aridus Industries and the patent-pending QDC Quick Detach Side Saddle Shell Carrier. Available now for pre-order. Would you like to know more? Visit AridusIndustries.com. So we are talking with Dave Harrington. Dave, are you still there?
Yeah.
Excellent. So I've been told to give you two shout-outs. One from Freddie Blish, who wanted to know how you liked your new Glock. So,
Robert did an outstanding job. Basically, what I did is through Fred, I spec'd out kind of a minimalist package in respect to baseline modifications to the Glock to make it that much more shootable. And they did an outstanding job. I did a photo shoot with Paul Liebenberg of Pistol Dynamics. That's one thing a lot of people don't know about Paul. He's a very accomplished photographer as well as outstanding 1911 Smith. And they should have, Robar should have it up on their website here fairly soon. And you can send,
send any Glock to them and they'll get it set up that same way?
Right, exactly.
Sweet. And then the other shout out was, let's see, how do I want to word this? CrossFit up in New Hampshire is wondering how the new Striker spring is working in your G34.
That's awesome. very well. As a matter of fact,
I try and make the listeners happy.
He's an outstanding dude. I did a 3-day integrated weapons gig up in New Hampshire about a month ago. And he's an outstanding individual, very motivated, has some good skills. and was basically Johnny on the spot for anything that needed to be done in addition to what we were already accomplishing.
Nice, nice. I was actually just in New Hampshire like a month ago, so I'm sad that I didn't make it your way. But
no worries.
Yeah, you know, next time, next time. So I want to hop back into it. One of the things that you were talking about was, you know, the public's consciousness of how to best handle these situations seems to be rapidly changing. And I, you know, I hate to say this, and it's a topic that, for whatever reason that I've yet to understand, is sort of fraught with pitfalls and things of that nature. But I really think that one of the best examples we can point to is sort of how Israel has had to deal with these problems over the last forever, you know?
Yeah, true. They've got a good template for, you know, dealing with that type of violence. And I don't think, you know, in this country, being, you know, a country of laws.
To be clear, what I was specifically talking about was just the acceptance that sometimes the bad guys need killed, you know?
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
It's just, even on a smaller scale, the point is the same. If, you know, you actively defend yourself and eliminate the threat by killing the individual, and of course, that would be my intent. The analysis, you know, the forensic analysis of the circumstances as they transpired, decisions will be made accordingly in respect of whether you're charged or not.
Right. Right. Well, so I guess let me ask you this. You know, it seems like in the past, a lot of people have focused on the one of the things that is my biggest pet peeves, and it's not even that it's not true, but it just seems very narrow or short-sighted. You hear things like, well, the typical gunfight is 3 shots in 3 seconds at 3 paces, and you don't need to know any more than that. And it was never really true, but it's certainly not true now. What do you think people need to do to be more prepared as far as skill sets go?
Well, regardless of, you know, skill set or skill level. However, you know, that's a very good question. The primary point of interest is, what is the measure of skill? How do you evaluate your abilities? I've always encouraged people to shoot competitively, whether it's in pursuit of, you know, IDPA, USPSA, Bullseye, PPC. Shooting competitively puts the onus on you to perform.
Right.
And it's about performance. In a formative stage, let's say an entry-level shooter, mentally they're more concerned about their application of the principles or fundamentals of shooting to what they are doing at that point in time. Whereas in the competitive realm, you don't have time to think through sight alignment, sight picture, how am I pressing the trigger, those types of baseline mechanics.
Right.
You do a stage analysis, come up with a shoot plan, and when the buzzer goes off, you have to execute. And it's the balance of speed and accuracy measured by, you know, shot placement on target and the overall time it took you to accomplish that course of fire that will bear out, you know, how you place. And both organizations, IDPA and USPSA respectively, have very effective skill analysis tools in respect to, you know, where you're at as far as the classification. I don't know
as far as like the rankings. So essentially what we're trying to do, and I'll paraphrase something I heard Ernest Langdon say when I was at his advanced tactical pistol class or whatever he calls it, but we're forcing people to become unconsciously competent with the pistol so that they are able to free up processing space to process problems.
Actually, let me clean that up for you.
Thank you.
What you want to do is, you know, through repetition of practice, training and practice, condition yourself in respect to, you know, operating or employing your firearms so you receive the conditioned response. One thing that's, I wouldn't say it's hard to achieve. I don't like really to describe anything as being hard to do, because if you tell someone something is hard to do, then that's what they expect.
Right.
So I try to stay away from that. What you're ultimately trying to achieve on an individual level is mental and physical synchronization. You want your baseline abilities, you want to be able to tap into that on demand. I don't, the whole problem solving portion has to be consciously done. Your conscious mind has to, you know, make the decisions and take the necessary actions. And what you're looking for ultimately is mental and physical synchronization, where the decision becomes the action.
So it's, instead of having a step-by-step process with time in between, it's all just kind of one thing.
Right, and I'll give you another example. Draw, aim, and fire. Very simple task.
Yep.
Okay. And from an entry-level standpoint, that is where that individual's mind very well may have to be with respect to getting the gun out on target, firing, and hitting it.
Right.
Whereas, depending on the skill level of people I'm working with, I may describe that as draw, aim, and fire, or I want you to simply mount the weapon and engage. Whereas describing it as mounting the gun on target, completely, it's much simpler to understand. But it's mounting the gun is all encompassing of, you know, making the decision to put your primary gun hand on the gun, formulate your grip, remove it from the holster, mount it up, acquire your sights. You see what I mean?
Right, right. Well, it's the same thing when you're first teaching someone and you're breaking down the draw stroke into steps or counts, you know, and some people have 3 or 4 counts, other people have like 20 count draw strokes, which don't get me started, but you know, it's just at the end of the day, what we're trying to get people to is draw, and that's one thing instead of, you know, 3 to 20 things depending on how you've learned it. What do you think, we got about 40 seconds left in this segment, I'll give you a hard one. What do you think the biggest mistake people make is when they're starting to learn all this stuff?
Expecting too much out of themselves.
Okay. So just...
They have a tendency to want to perform at a higher level than what they actually can mentally comprehend.
All right. Let's go to break real quick. We're talking with Dave Harrington. When we get back, we'll get right back into that. Right now, you're listening to Ballistic Radio.
55 KRC, the talk station.
Missing don't fix anything.
Electric
problems at home? I guess. That'd be quickie. No, that's good.
6150.
Yes. When are you starting the music? 57, 56. So you're starting the music at 5750? Copy. No, it'll be fine.
Fury Automotive, right by you, is right there in helping to alleviate childhood hunger in our community this holiday season. Now through January 4th, for any of Fury Automotive. store food bank, containing various food items enough to feed each child up to 3 meals. Gary Automotive's goal is to provide over 10,000 children with power tools. The free store food bank at Gary Automotive, right there and helping eliminate childhood hunger. For more details, go to GaryAutomotive.com.
Glenn Beck. This will blow your mind. Tomorrow at 9:06 on 55 KRC, the talk station.
Welcome back to Ballistic Radio. This segment brought to you by Tac Strike Steel Target Systems, makers of the quarter scale steel target and the arch frame target stand, which are literally the best steel targets and target stands I've ever used. Hit their steel targets with more than 60,000 rounds of rifle, pistol, and shotgun ammunition without a single problem. For more information, visit them at TacStrike.com. And also, Aridus Industries and the patent-pending QDC Quick Detach Side Saddle Shell Carrier, available now for pre-order. Check out the new rigid, interchangeable side saddle carrier, changing how you look at shotguns forever. Find out why Steve Fisher, Chris Fry, and myself all call it the best hard-mount side saddle carrier ever invented. Would you like to know more? Visit AridusIndustries.com. Do you like the Serenity lead-in, Jack?
I'm so happy.
Don't stand up. Just don't stand up, because we got video going now and then. Well, oh, God. Anyway, oh, yeah, we've got live radio, too. I need to watch what I say. Dave, are you still there?
Yeah, man.
So as far as, you know, shooters trying to do too much too quickly, I was at a Tom Givens instructor class trying to set a record on his casino drill that he's got. And I'd have done it, too, if I hadn't dropped that one shot. But the funny thing is, if I had just taken an extra tenth of a second and landed that shot, I'd have still been under the time, and I was just pushing faster than I could go. Is that what you're talking about?
That's a good example, yeah.
Okay. So how do people, I mean, how do you develop the shooting discipline not to do that?
It's experience-based. I mean, I see, you know, when I run a program, I don't have, like, 40 prereqs.
Right.
I'm not concerned about an individual skill level, simply because, in some respects, you know, coming back to the thing we covered earlier about how do you quantify your skill, how do you evaluate your ability, that is so esoterically out there. You can ask somebody, you know, what is your skill level, and they just simply are not going to say, well, I'm an entry-level guy.
Right.
I'm intermediate. Or, you know, people have a tendency to, it's not everybody, it's just, you know, an anomaly that, you know, people don't generally understand how to evaluate their skill.
What do you think a good way to do that is?
Well, there's no, one of the simplest exercises that you can fire to evaluate strict marksmanship ability is 25-yard bullseye. 25-yard visible at 25 yards, 10 rounds, 10 minutes, which is more than enough time.
Right.
That's 1 minute per shot. And what is, you know, where you score? Of course, you start, you know, with a potential 100 points. And as you fire each shot, you're going to acquire, you know, X number of hits. One thing I've always done when I start a practice session of my own is I start with strict marksmanship exercises, you know, 25-yard bulls, or grouping exercises at different, you know, distances and respective, you know, the respective size of the target supports the distance I'm firing at. But I expect at least 80%
right
on demand, so, with all hits in the black. Another way of looking at it, from a standpoint of shooting that specific exercise, 25-yard bullet, 25 yards, exponentially, the black on the NRA 25-yard target, pistol target, is 6 inches. If you can't achieve all hits in the black at 25 yards, to me, you know, that is respectable baseline marksmanship ability, then I can build on that. And, of course, the 25-yard bullseye, to me, represents a headshot.
Well, a lot of people don't seem to... A lot of people don't want to imagine a scenario where that's what they have to do, it seems like to me.
You know? Well, then they'll fail.
Right, right.
That's my one. You need to be as rounded, as well-rounded as possible. There is no, you know, nobody has a crystal ball. You can't second-guess yourself. And what I do know is under pressure, if you do not have absolute confidence in your ability, the chances of you taking that shot, let alone making the shot, it's not going to happen.
But do you think that, let me ask you this, do you think people default to taking shots that they don't think they can make, or do they default to not taking shots they might make? I mean, I know that's like a weird way to phrase that question, but you know what I mean?
Yeah, I'll clean that up for you, too.
Thank you.
The bottom line is, at what point do you have a measurable or a quantifiable level of skill, and what do you do to progress your abilities? You simply have to challenge yourself. And there's people that, you know, fall into the trap of shooting the same types of exercises over and over. And that's all they do. And that's just self-limiting in and of itself. Whereas, you know, coming back to the competitive advantage, you are always required to problem solve. Even within a stage itself, you may have a relatively close target array that requires fast action and fast execution. Then for the next portion, you may have to, you know, put on the brakes a little bit. You know, it's generally called a speed trap, where you have to take a low percentage shot at distance and then close that course of fire out with another piece of fast action work. It's like hit the gas. And that's a very difficult thing to do. You have to be, you know, mentally prepared to do something like that, physically capable of executing cleanly. And there's always the mental and physical synchronization required to simply do it instead of trying to think your way through it while you're doing it. It's not going to work.
Right. Right. So that's all things that people need to have really worked on and developed before they find themselves in a situation where they have to do it live, for lack of a better.
You may not have the luxury of time to do that.
Okay.
You know, again, you can only be as prepared as you are at that point in time, regardless of, you know, measurable skill. And there's always the will to survive that weighs heavily on, you know, dealing with a violent confrontation. You know, do you have the mentality, oh crap, I just got hit, I'm out of action, or hey, I just took a hit, you know, I need to close this thing out.
Right. Well, and that seems to really separate people that are good at this multiple times versus people that get lucky one time. You know, is that...
Well, there's always an element of luck.
Yeah, yeah.
The, it's hard to quantify combat. You can do everything right and still get whacked.
And that seems to be another reality that people don't want to think about.
Right. You know, a lot of people... it escapes them to, especially if you're going to get involved in a profession that requires the use of weapons, firearms. I'll give you an example. Just within the army itself, you've got your straight line infantry guy, who's basically, you know, total focus is on firing maneuver in an open air environment. And then you have you know, your higher level of training in respect to CTB, stuff like that. You know, at some point in time, you know, the individual has to look themselves in the mirror and make a decision whether they're willing to get blown away at point blank range, you know?
Right, right.
It's just, you really can't make sense out of it.
Well, we're coming up on the end of the show, man. We got about a minute and 10 seconds left. Now you're pretty much done on classes for this year, since we're coming up on the end of the year very shortly. But next year, do you know where you're going to be at? Where can people find you at if they want to come train with you? Tell the listeners.
Baseline website. It's more of an information push website. It's combatspeed.com. I'm my own worst enemy when it comes to self promotion. I kind of fly under the radar screen.
Right.
I primarily do work based on, you know, by request. And you can reach me at combatspeedllc@aol.com. That's my working email.
Cool.
Primarily by word of mouth. And
I gotta ask, man, the video that you got posted of you on the treadmill on YouTube, did you expect that to get the millions of views that it has so far?
I had no idea that thing would do what it did. Me and a buddy of mine, Pat Gilmore, I was actually using that as a training tool for a SOCOM element here out of McBill Air Base. And we were using the Hillsborough County Sheriff Range, and I had that set up. And Pat asked me, hey man, why don't you let me shoot a little video clip.
And it just went from there. Nice.
And I posted that on Facebook, and it blew up.
There you go. Well, hey man, I appreciate you coming on the show tonight. Unfortunately, we gotta get. I'll definitely have you back on if you want to. So,
No worries.
All right, man. Be safe, brother. I will talk to you later.
I appreciate the opportunity, John. You take care, man.
Hey, you too. So next week, I don't know. I never know, but it'll be somebody cool talking about something cool. Remember, you can listen to past episodes at BallisticRadio.com, like our Facebook page at Facebook.com/BallisticRadio. Thanks for listening, everyone. As always, be safe. See you next week. So you're playing a rerun for Dr. Cohen? So can we use the studio for a minute then? Cool. Now you go turn the headphones down over there, Jack, so that... All righty. Yay, another live broadcast. What did you guys think? Just good? Should we keep doing this? Maybe. Oh, wait, there's a delay, so it's going to take a second for...
It's not as bad of a delay tonight.
Hmm. I wonder what's up with that. Jack's over in the corner doing lewd things. Don't forget our headphones too. Under that. Don't knock the camera over when you remove it.
There's no way for me to get those without
doing things. Yeah. All right, fine.
But they're unplugged, so all we gotta do is pull them.
That's good. Rin says keep doing it.
The lewd things or
wait, the lewd things or the wait for the response here. Why are you sitting all close to me, fucker? They can see you over there.
Yeah, I can't see the chat. I didn't know what was going on.
Okay. We disappointed Melody.
Well, after, you know, all that Ray of Sunshine crap.
What the fuck is that shit?
She turns out she's
everyone.
Just
this is great. This is great. Oh no, it sucks. Oh, look there. It's snuggling.
She's been drinking.
She's been drinking. I need to like sit up more straight and
straight.
Yeah. My takeaway was you'll get there. Try build drill at 25 yards on a 3x5. That sucks. Did you see the video I posted of the saline test where I was doing
yeah,
a bit?
Yeah, I saw it.
I can't do it at 25. I was just trying to make him feel bad.
I was about to say, because I saw it, and that wasn't 25.
near, that wasn't 25.
10 or 12, something like that?
It was 10. It was a build drill.
10 still sucks. Like,
it sucks at 7 when you're trying to go quick. Where are we in here?
10 or 12, something like that.
10.
It was a build drill.
This is so weird.
I know.
It's like, I'm seeing the past. It's a time machine.
We didn't even have to get up to 88 miles per hour.
See, I don't know what he's phrasing, though, because I've already said so many things.
Yeah, Eric, you got to give us a reference point. Like,
and the hobo gloves are going back on.
Of course. Are your hands still cold in here?
It's not that they're cold. It's just they hurt. Mm-hmm. I thought we've covered this.
Yeah. But I thought they hurt when they got cold.
They just kind of hurt and warmth. Helps. That, and if I sweat more, I use more weight or something, right? I'm just hoping Molly Ringwald will show up.
Don't you
forget about me. Anyway, we're not doing this. We're not doing this.
The next 2 months, I got your ass. That is such a weird movie.
Do you guys want to come in and be on a Google Hangout? Do you want to show the 15 people in here the magic behind the glass?
14.
Well, all right. I'll introduce you as the dude that cost me money, so that's good. Come here, Brad. Wait, what are we doing? Oh, the yeah.
Okay.
I'm like, what, Molly Ringwald? Where? Why don't I have video? And can it be young Molly Ringwald?
Either way.
It's Molly Ringwald. That's.
It's not like Sarah Jessica Parker or something, you know.
I still. What? She's cute. She's a cute girl. She's from Cincinnati.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. I got carry fever. The only time we don't speak is during Sex in the City. It's from a song.
I have never heard that song.
You are a fucking liar. You've never heard that song.
The only time we don't speak is during Sex in the City?
Yep.
I got so happy with the Serenity music tonight. I'm not even going to lie.
Any 1911s? Yes. Yes, I am definitely going to get one of the CMP 1911s whenever that happens.
I don't think I should.
Why?
Because I'd want to like take it to some gunsmith and have it like put modern sights on it and clean it up and everything.
I'm doing that.
Okay. Because like
I already know. I'm gonna send it to Combat Precision. Free shout out. Get like a Chen Magwell fucking.
Yeah, because like I hate guys that are like, oh, these need to be kept pristine. Like these are old war horses. Like you gotta get them back up to shape.
No, I think I did say I would nail Sarah Jessica Parker. Famous people are attractive.
I think he was talking to me.
Oh, who, you?
Yeah.
Famous people are attractive because they're famous, right? Isn't that how the world works?
I don't know about that, man.
Oh, come on, dude. You and Michael Moore that one time? Ooh, that didn't happen just because of his looks.
Whoa, bro.
Whoa, man. Man. Okay, wait.
You ready, mate?
Oh. I love this song, actually. I'm. Look for me, young me, cruising down the west side highway, doing what we like to do. I never know where your rap game is at.
Fucking better than yours, apparently.
Because you got one Jay-Z deep cut that I didn't recognize right off the top?
Hold on. Bam!
Fair.
I win.
Oh!
Hey, Brad!
Right. Just, it's right there.
It's right there.
You were fine. You were fine.
Yeah. Say hi. Hello, world. Hello. There's only like 12 people in here.
Dude. Oh, hey, 12 people. What's going on? There I am.
Yeah. See, there's like a delay.
It's quite a delay.
It was worse last week. Last week was like a 3-minute delay.
Oh.
Like the show was still going on. We left.
So Brad cost me $1,500, Warren.
$1,500.
But it's okay.
But that was my first day by myself actually producing a show. And I don't know what happened. I don't remember.
You know what it was? You sent an episode to one of the other markets, and the title in the Dropbox or whatever was like one number off of a season 1 episode. So it was all right. It's the reason I didn't get mad at you is because it was an honest mistake. Mm-hmm. Now, that one guy that was in here like drunk and high and fucked up on that one shit that one time, and Strucker had to come in.
That's a different story. Yes. That was definitely a different story.
That's a different story.
That's why I came in and tried to clean it up.
You did all right.
I do okay. You do all right. But how was the show today? Did we have a good show?
It was okay. I mean, other than him hitting like the Fox News button in the middle of the show and like playing the... Yes. Yeah, that's why he's hiding behind the glass. He's like, I'm not fucking
going to do that. He don't know.
No, he's like, no.
We got Delta Force on the line like, oh, you should really consider this the Fox News brief. Kevin, like, I'm looking at John. John's like,
fucking. Where's Minion? Where's Minion?
This is the new.
The new Minion?
He's a Manion.
Manion? Jesus.
Yeah.
Fucking body slam.
Here, stand up, Jack. Just.
What the fuck am I going to do?
Die.
I'll get thrown through one of these soundproof walls.
They're only soundproof until you get thrown through
it. After that. It's more like sound resistant.
So someone wants to know if you're the dude that plays the Bent Dick commercials, and that's not you.
The curved penis commercials.
The Peyronie's.
Peyronie's disease.
We didn't get it tonight.
Yeah, we had no Bent Dick tonight. For some reason, we had the. Apparently, they pay pretty good. The curved penis guys.
I'm fine with that.
Like, you know what? I'll play curved penis after curved penis.
You'll do what with the curved penis?
I'll play the commercial.
I just feel like you should warn us. Because the first time it happened...
Oh, my God, it's great. The first time it happened, it was like, all right, 30 seconds. Do you or your partner suffer from a curved penis?
And this is my first time, and I'm like looking at him. I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
We played one of those during an NKU basketball game. And the play-by-play guy for NKU is also one of the play-by-play guys for the Cincinnati Reds. And you would have thought we yelled like fuck and shit and pissed because it was almost hilarious, his reaction. Like I was in tears, his reaction. And this was on a sports channel down the hall here.
Yeah.
And it was one of the funniest reactions I've ever heard from anyone in this building.
Hmm.
So that was kind of, I mean, it's kind of a lame.
What'd he do? Like, there's all this build up about his reaction.
Was he on air?
No, he wasn't on air.
Oh, then it doesn't matter. Do you even remember remember Wildman Walker?
Oh, yeah.
Remember that he was the helicopter pilot, right? Or no, who was the helicopter pilot for EBM?
That was before my time.
I know that, but do you know who I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
Do you remember, were you alive when he was landing the helicopter at Lincoln Field, saw a gopher and fucking blasted it with his 44 Magnum from the helicopter?
That is probably one of the most badass stories. I've not heard that story.
So here's the thing about that. So, and see, this is salient to what we were talking about since the gun story. Have you ever been in a helicopter?
I've not.
Okay, so they're flying that. They need two hands and 2 feet because they're controlling the rotation of the tail with the feet, you know, and they've got the pitch and all that, and they've got the collective, which is the throttle of the rotor blades and all that, that they control with their other hand. So he's not flying the helicopter anymore.
He's shooting a gopher.
Well, so yeah. And that was a big deal, but I mean, I'm like, this has got to be the 80s or early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, because I was young. And they're like, oh yeah, they don't have air traffic right now because his pilot's license has been suspended.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
What I love about that is Homeboy strapped on that 44 Magnum for years in that helicopter. Just like one day,
he was
going to be a live pursuit, and he's just going to like, bam, worth it.
Well, this is like a different fucking time.
Yeah.
I mean, this is like the Reagan and Bush years.
Oh.
Back when America was good or something like that.
Back when America was good, the good old days of America, and you could carry a 44 Magnum on an airplane.
Well, you can still carry a 44 Magnum on an airplane if you know how to do it right. If you get that. Anyway, it wouldn't be my first pick, personally. But anyway. All right, get the fuck out now.
All right. Adios, amigos.
Bye.
Can we get a stand-up door for, like, a breaching thing?
What do you want to breach?
I made my joke about wanting to turn my shotgun into a breacher, not because I need one, but just so I could call it Adele. Hello from the other side. And I just had a guy who runs like a really big Facebook page. Like, if you will make that video, I'll share it with 3 million people. So, well, I'll tell you about it later.
Yeah, I think I can find a fucking door.
Yeah, I think we can find a door.
I'm a attention whore.
Fuck. I'm going to let you finish.
Yeah, we know Alliance has a breaching range, Tom. You're telling me. I fucking sponsor the shoot house at Alliance.
Helicopter subject matter expert.
I know they crash for like totally no reason.
It's 6,000 parts moving, hopefully in the same direction.
It's more than 6,000. Anyway, you guys have anything else? Anything? We got to go play D&D.
Yes. Oh, the waitress today.
Oh. Yeah, I guess that is a good point.
Oh. Wow.
I'm sorry.
The fuck was that?
That light burnout.
Okay.
Here, here! Contact!
Ah! Death Blossom!
Don't go all bazookas in here. All right. Wait, is he dusting his dice bag in a chat?
Yeah.
Wait, that's actually pretty standard.
Dude, I have friends.
This chat roulette?
Worst chat roulette. We should pull up chat roulette one time just to like see some like the person like, what are you guys doing? Having a radio show.
Where are we at in here? I'm curious.
This is pull up chat roulette one time just to like.
All right. Okay, do you guys have anything else? I'll even type it. Don't you fucking yawn.
I got that other monster waiting on me. That's going to be good.
I'm really glad I didn't have anything pulled up when I flipped over. It's like, oh, that's right. Yeah, I know. I've got actual dice, too. Wait, are we still talking about balls or no?
I don't know. All right. I didn't get my post on Mosa Nap, so, like...
Yeah, all right. Okay, I'm just...
Mark Lowell for president. I'll open that up right here. I'll vote for Mark Lowell for president.
Is that a... Wow. Yes. Yes, it is. And it is a 2XL.
You're like Haley now.
Dead sexy?
Oh, wow. Weird.
Weird. I like the new webcam. The angle's better.
Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, that's what all the professionals use.
So I said to Jack, we need a webcam. He's like, let me see what the cam girls get naked with.
So I called my cam girlfriend and I was like, hey, what do you use? And she was like, oh, I use this thing. It's great.
Is this long enough for a braid yet?
No. Not even close. Hmm. I found a used one. I can't get a good hand on the size.
Handle. These hands. If you kill me before you can assume my identity, it's all for nothing.
The real quick, checking how these eight people paying them off.
That's true, too. All right.
Yep.
Guys.
It's been real.
Well, so the problem is I don't actually have the button pulled up. Okay, now.